He has worked with Lars von Trier on Melancholia, Nymphomaniac, and others. With Nicholas Winding Refn on Only God Forgives. And he does music, sound design, and also works as a sound editor and orchestrator on both fictional pieces and documentaries. To top things off, he's a very nice guy and really knowledgeable. Who is that jack of all trades? You will figure out after the main title. So this is Ansett, and you are welcome to Soundfiles.
I'm Kristian Eidnes Andersen, and I am a Danish composer and sound designer, and I have been that for around 30 years. My work with Lars von Trier has meant a lot to me because it's really inspiring, and it's great films to work on, and Lars is a great director to work for. But I also work with documentary feature film with different subjects and indie films, because I think it's interesting to use the way I work in feature films in the documentary genre also, because the modern way to tell stories in documentary is very alike in the fiction film. And I know that people would say that you may not use dramatic elements in documentaries, but if you are true to the story and don't overdo it, I think it's totally okay. And if you can say you manipulate your audience anyway when you put two pictures, two edits together, so that the honest documentary doesn't, the clean documentary doesn't exist. It will always be perspective from the director and the filmmakers. So if you just do it with respect for the characters and the subject, then I think it's a great way to emphasize the effect documentary film can have on people, because it's real life. And that's also what I really like with working with documentaries. It's real human beings you are telling a story about, and actually often also meet them. And it's not I don't favor that, but I think it's a very good variation to do fiction film, because you also get your feet on your ground. If the style of my compositions don't fit the film, it's have no relevance, and then I do the sound design. I have a collaboration with the composer, with respect for her or his music, or more often that I'm the composer alone, and then I give my work to another sound designer with a little trembling, because will they treat it right? No, it's for fun. If it suits the film that I can do both, then it's actually quite smart, because I can incorporate the music in the sound design directly, and have the direct contact with the director with both matters. In Lars von Trier's film, I have been doing the sound design for several of his films, and in the early films I was supervising sound editor, actually for my together with my teacher, Pierre Streit, who made the first or the earlier Lars von Trier film. I was a supervising sound editor on these, and it was sound design only. And then slowly I did arrangements and the crossover things you could call score. But Lars don't use score music that much, actually. Not in newer time, he hasn't used score. We have more working with abstract sound design used as score. And then, of course, I have arranged and re-recorded existing pieces like Handel and Wagner in Melancholia and Handel in Antichrist and César Franck in Nymphomaniac, for instance, and in that way take responsibility of the producing of some of the existing works, which is very exciting as composer also, because it's quite wonderful works to work with. I think teaching is important because you have to be generous and give your knowledge to others, so they don't. I think one of the struggles in my time when I was very young, I was very young when I started, I actually maybe 17 when I started diving into film composing, or you know, in small degree, and it was so difficult to get something to know about how to do, and you know, people was very close. What was my feeling about how is this functioning? How can I get into the right places? Where should I take education, etc., etc.? It's not. I don't feel that's. It's so common anymore, but it was at that time, and that's also gives me an idea that I should not be like that. I want to be open and give my knowledge to the younger generation so they can choose and, you know, what they can use of that and maybe become better in a faster way, because there's no reason to. I always say other success can't do any harm to me, so it's just to, you know, give out all your knowledge. And it gives me a lot of joy to talk with the students and get inspiration from them, because they have so many other angles to what I say, and you know, it's a really good way to always keep your in sharp and try new ways that you just don't do the actual same and the same and the same. You learn all your life, and I have that principle that if I can't learn anymore, then I have to stop, because then it's become just repetitive, doing the same and same and same. So I hopefully, and I feel I can learn new things all the time still, and you know, so, and of course I did learn a lot after school, because also I have this close relationship with my teacher from school. But I would probably also have had learned a lot with another more skilled person. But I don't use templates, because then I, you know, neither in the head or in the physical way in the computer programs. If I'm going to make a piece of music, I always try to put up new instruments to rethink. Is this, of course, if I do orchestral piece, I can reuse orchestral setup, but if I use special articulations or special electronic instruments, I don't reuse. But I, of course, I have a tone, because I'm me, and I will get into a tone probably heard before, but I try to make these small manipulations with myself and my work method, so I don't just reuse and redo exactly the same again and again. It's fun when it's the speed in the process, but it should not be a practical speed. It should be because I'm in flow and things is coming, and you can, you know, process a lot of work in a short time. That's of course fun, but it's not the goal that you make a technical setup which make it we do like we did last time, so it's going fast. I try to be involved as early as possible, so that I can discuss it on while the script is written, and it happens often, but of course it's not in the real world, it can't be that always, but it's really nice if you can be in the early stages, because then you're part of the process of develop the sound and the music, how to use it and how much and the aesthetics, orchestration and stuff like that. And then you can speed up the workflow when you go into the editing, of course, because then you don't get temp music, so you get your mark on the film together with the editing. So that's the most proper way to do it, because then you develop together with the director and the editor. And for me, sound and music is, you know, in a film is a whole, because it's like a big score. You just have dialogue as soloists, and you have atmosphere as harmonies, and you can use repetition, you can use crescendos, your disharmonic stuff. For me, it's obvious that so as much as possible put in the script or anyway talked about in forehand is great, because then the director and the photographer in that matter could think about how the sound and music would affect the scenes already in when they shoot the film. But of course you can't do a totally in the real world, you can't plan totally in forehand, but in special areas, and talking about Lars von Trier, he is very keen on agreeing about musical parts, where should prologue, for instance, epilogues, special sound design should be in the background and be a marker for this and that. So there's a lot of stuff tried out already before shooting or during shooting. Of course, during shooting, there's less time to do anything else than shooting, but before and just right after in the editing.
Is the most unreal vocalist of all time. He is the voice of Sirith Ungol. He, of course, is Tim Baker. When I first heard Sirith Ungol, I thought to myself, this cannot be real. The backing music by itself is not that special on its own. Yet Tim Baker's vocals push it beyond everything heard before or since. It's 8 solid songs with an okay production, but still outstanding in total, with, of course, 1 foot in hell.